Just drove up from Baltimore. I live in Baltimore. I'm from Baltimore. One of those amazing Rust Belt cities that you know so well. I just spent a month. I spent all of February in Lesbos, in Greece, in a small island. If you're familiar with the crisis, if you're familiar with Greece, if you've ever been there or know people who have, it's interesting in a lot of ways. It's like the Caribbean. It's like this beautiful place with this awful, awful reality behind it. So I was there. I was there for a month volunteering. I was working on beaches. I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to start with. And then, of course, I'm going to be performing later tonight as well. I'm also a musician, like a political folk singer and a storyteller. How many people here are familiar with the refugee crisis in the Middle East and beyond right now? Cool, that's a lot of people. How many folks are familiar with the political crisis in Europe right now? The rise of fascism, the border walls that are going up for the first time since the Second World War, things like this. And how many of you all are familiar with like the context of some of the factors that are driving some of these refugee situations? The civil war in Syria, the war in Iraq, Afghanistan, Central Africa, all of this. So this is, I want to start with just a quick overview. So I'm just an activist, right? I come out of the anti-war movement. The night we started bombing Afghanistan, I went out with a little homemade sign. I was like, I don't know, 15 years old, 16 years old? No, I was 17, whatever, it doesn't matter. I got attacked by a group of patriotic Americans, and had my sign stolen from me. That was cool. That's how I learned about some of this work. And then I watched over the next 2 years as the engine revved up to invade Iraq. And you saw this whole war get manufactured on television. Really interesting experience to see that. And like everyone knew it was crap, but it just kept rolling. You know, it's kind of like Donald Trump's candidacy where you're like, everyone knows he's lying, and it actually literally doesn't matter if he is or not. It doesn't. No one cared if there was legitimacy to the war in Iraq. I should say no one. Half the population didn't care. Half totally did. But it didn't bother the people in power at all. But we saw the population shift. We saw the anti-war movement grow. And the anti-war movement was really successful in some ways. It was successful in what didn't happen, right? We didn't invade Iran. We didn't directly invade Syria. We didn't invade Venezuela. That's the successes. The failures was that we didn't stop the wars. That was what we set out to do. But stopping a war is not an easy thing to do. And what's happening right now, and where we're seeing it is in Greece. We're seeing it on the TV in Greece and on the border of Macedonia. These are... among other things, a big chunk of this situation is fallout from the wars that we started, right? The work that is to be done, the solidarity work in this situation, is follow-up from the anti-war movement. I know people who fought in Vietnam who were soldiers, who became anti-war activists, who still do work in Vietnam with communities affected by the wars. And this is the talk I'm trying to give to people, and this is the word I'm trying to spread, is that if you were against the war then, we have to follow up now. And it might be multi-decade long project, but this is a responsibility that we have. A lot of other people have responsibility in this situation too, and I'll talk about that. So what's happening right now, right? Last year, 1 million refugees came to Europe, and this became known as the refugee crisis. I have to preface all of this by saying Europe doesn't have a refugee crisis. The refugees are having crises. Europe is not having a crisis. Europe is having a political crisis related to the refugees coming in. Lebanon is having a refugee crisis. 25% of that country is a refugee right now. Europe has 211 million people. A million people coming in last year, that's not a crisis. It's a manufactured, they've manufactured this idea that Europe is can't deal with it, and it's just out of control. It's a lot of people, but that's, you know, I mean, I was just reading what in 1908 or something, the U.S. had 1 million people enter, all refugees, and economic migrants, and it wasn't a big deal at all. And in fact, like half of Europe has negative population growth rates. So actually, they need more people to have children to grow their economies at the rate that they're growing. So actually, they should be accepting new people. I'll talk more about that. But I just need to preface that Turkey has 3 million refugees. Lebanon has almost 2 million. Jordan has between 500,000 and 1 million, depending on which statistics you read. And there's twice as many people internally displaced. So it's very interesting to that the news that we see is from Europe. It's Europe's experience of a crisis. That said, this comes at a time when Europe's economy just was very threatened with collapse. The Eurozone is threatened with collapse right now. It's getting pulled apart by different factors. And so there's a political crisis in Europe. People have sort of wrongfully ascribed this to the refugees. There's been recent right-wing parties that formed directly around the refugees, or really like attached themselves to it, such as in Sweden and in Germany, this new group called Alternative for Germany. But most of the right-wing parties in Europe started before the crisis began and have been mobilizing in Hungary. Hungary's government is far right-wing, and they've been in power since 2010, actually. And then there's other parties like the Golden Dawn in Greece, which is a neo-Nazi party, third largest party in the country. Hasn't grown at all since last year when the refugee crisis started in Greece. So Golden Dawn hasn't actually grown as a response, right? There's a lot of things coalescing. There's a right-wing movement from the economy and from Europe's twisted history. And now the crisis is the new face of it. Getting into that, has anyone here been over to any of the affected countries? So I want to talk quickly about what the work looked like that I did in Greece. I can't talk much about some of the other countries. I can tell you that when you hear the word refugee, often people in the U.S. think refugee means poor, right? That's like one of the first images that people think of, right? In fact, most of the people that I interacted with on beaches like this one were not poor. They were from middle-class families. Maybe they were poor, but their family had money that they put into their trip. To get a seat on this boat, if you want to call that a boat, 50 people cram onto those every single night. We had 5 last night in the beaches I worked at in Greece. 50 people, $1,500 per person. That's just a rubber boat. It's a crap boat. They pretty much deflate the minute they get to the shore. You can see that this one's already started deflating. They sink all the time. They're made of rubber and wood, just a couple pieces of plywood.
What is the name of the island?
This is Lesbos.
Okay, thanks. Mm-hmm. We're looking for it.
Oh, yeah. It's in the north, it's right near Turkey in the northeast.
Okay, thanks.
Of the islands. But so, the poorest refugees from these wars aren't getting on these boats. They're staying in the region. They're staying in the country. So that's an important thing to know. We had people like that would get off the boat and they would have like a really nice smartphone, and we wouldn't even have phone service on our phones to call the bus that was going to pick them up. And they'd be like on the phone with people in Afghanistan, like telling their family they made it. And you'd be like, can I use your phone? and people dressed in really nice clothing as well. And people coming, so what happens? I'll talk about this first. So what does it look like in Greece, right? So this little island is Lesbos, right? It's by far the busiest of the Greek islands. If you don't know too much about the crisis, long story short, there's 3 million refugees in Turkey from all over the place, but the majority are from Syria. They don't want to be in Turkey. They don't want to live in Turkey. They've come to Turkey because it's close to Europe and because they can work in Turkey to get enough money to get on a boat for $1,500, that's the cheap one, to get to Europe, where they've been told by several countries, Sweden and Germany specifically, that if they show up there, that they'll be allowed to stay there. Some of these people have been working for a year in Turkey, getting enough money to pay for the whole family to come, right? So when a few weeks ago Europe announced no more refugees can come in, you've got people who've been spending a year planning this. They might have spent the year before that planning the journey and planning the escape. So I don't know what's happening, but it's not that big of a deal. So Lesbos is the busiest of the islands in Greece, right? It's 6 kilometers, 7 kilometers from Turkey. In this picture, you can see, so that's Turkey up there. You can barely see it. This is one of the main points where I worked. Turkey's right there. With a good pair of binoculars, you can see people standing on the beach. What happens is people get bused to beaches like that beach over there from all over the western edge end of Turkey. They hide in the woods for a day or two, sometimes in the freezing rain, sometimes in the snow, sometimes in really, really hot weather. And they wait until a smuggler has gone and bribed the Turkish Coast Guard enough money to let them bring their boat up. People say, oh, they're not all taking bribes. Most people you talk to will say, oh yeah, they definitely took bribes. There's no way that we could have gotten out without doing a bribe. That said, it's a big coastline. Anyways, so then they get on a boat. Usually they're told by the smuggler, which is often a human trafficker. Now, it's not all human trafficking, right? Like, legally, this is the term that they use. They're all human traffickers. I don't consider somebody to be a human trafficker if they're giving me a ride somewhere I want to go, whether it's illegal or not. However, even if somebody is bringing people somewhere they want to go, where are they coming from? They're from the Albanian mafia. They're from the Georgian mafia. They're from Turkish fascist mafias, right? They are involved in human trafficking, too. So often they are human traffickers doing a service in the rare exception that somebody actually wants them to do, which is bring them to Greece. This is one of the kinds of boats that they bring them in. So those rubber boats will have no one on them who knows how to drive the boat. They'll just put all the refugees on and push them into the water, turn the motor on, and say, all right, good luck. Figure out how that motor works. This boat showed up with no smuggler on board, so no one who was knew how to drive a boat. I'll show you other pictures. We had a boat come with 180 people on it, like a ferry. No one driving the boat. We asked who was driving the boat, and this woman just pointed to the sky. And these boats just find their way over. They just float. And then what happens is back a year ago, these boats would just come to places like this lighthouse where you can see all this wreckage. I'll show you other photos of it. They would just smash into the rocks and sink right there. And so here's a boat that sank. This came with 140 people on it, this boat, or 135, something like this. That's right out at the right lighthouse. So they would just smash into those rocks. Everyone would go into the water. It'd be the middle of the night because there's a lighthouse. They come to the light. And that's what was happening. And the villagers were dealing with the situation, these little tiny villages. Some of these beaches have 2-3 people that live there. And they would, every night, would be getting hundreds of people on the beaches, you know? And last year, of course, 712 people drowned in this crossing, in the Greek islands in general, right? So people were dealing with a lot of really traumatic situations last year. So groups started to come to Lesbos. There were all these news stories in the summer of tourists who had come there, and they're on the beach, and then a boat full of refugees comes up, and then they end up helping out, and then they ended up staying because, you know, they couldn't just not do anything in that situation. And eventually all these international volunteers started coming, activists, NGOs, different organizations from all over the world, a lot of them from Europe, started coming. And there's good parts about that and there's bad parts about it, right? There's definitely like a nonprofit industrial complex that I'm sure some of us know about, and you definitely see it manifested. You see people who come for like just a couple days to volunteer, and you see some of this like problematic behavior and problematic language on the Facebook groups that volunteers are involved in. You know, there seems to be some of the ways people reflect on being there is very like self-directed, like, it felt so good for me to be there, you know, I felt so good helping, and there's a lot of this kind of stuff that I shy away from, and often you see people like that interacting with refugees like they're not people. Like, the refugees are actually part of making this person feel good about themselves, or like, you know, whatever, whether it's politics or religion or something else, there's some other thing that they want to get fulfilled, right? Then there's other groups, and some of these volunteers, you can't control what a volunteer is going to be like if you're an organization. You can't just blame it all on the organizations. There's some really good NGOs doing really, really important work there. I worked really closely with Doctors Without Borders. I appreciate everything about that organization. I have political differences with some of their policies. I really respected the work that they did. Greenpeace was there with a rescue boat. There's an amazing organization from Spain called Proactiva, which are it's a national organization of lifeguards in Spain, and they've sent all these boats over, volunteers. There's a rescue boat volunteer group from Germany called Sea Watch that's operating out there that we worked with a lot. A bunch of groups like that. There's a Norwegian group called Team Humanity that does the rescue boats. There's NGOs on a bunch of the different beaches, right? So over here, there's a beach called Scala, Skunias, but we just call it Scala. And that's like one of the busiest points of the island. And then in the far south, Mytilene, the capital, is the busiest part of the island. Most of the NGOs are in those beaches, okay? So what happened is last fall or the end of last summer, my friend Matt is driving from the Scala to Mytilene, and he makes a wrong turn because none of the roads have names. It's a very old school island. No road names, no street signs, just dirt roads. You just know where you're going. And he takes a wrong turn and he ends up in this tiny little village called Clio. And there's like 300 refugees walking up this dirt road. And he ends up giving a bunch of them rides further up the road, buying them water and stuff like this. And then he's talking to one of the villagers, and he said, you know, he had just been volunteering for a week at Scala with all these organizations, hundreds of volunteers for every boat, you know. And here's all these people with no one there. And he said, who operates in the village? And the villager said, what do you mean? He said, do any, you know, NGOs work here? And they said, no. He said, well, who helps the refugees? They said, just us, just the villagers. And so what was happening back then is that I'm pretty sure it was the Greek mafia, but they just said the mafia. I think it's the Greek mafia was, when they could, would go down to the beach and they would tell the refugees, oh yeah, it's a really long drive up the mountain. I'll take you. It'll be $300 or whatever. And so they were charging the refugees hundreds of dollars, hundreds of euros to drive them 2-3 kilometers up a hill. But they don't know. They don't know how far the walk is. And back then, also, people were walking from up here to the capital, Mytilene, which is about an hour-long drive. In the middle of the summer, people were walking with all their stuff, families, everybody, injured people, anyone. And so it was a bit of a crisis on Lesbos. People's fields were getting destroyed. You know, these are farmers, right? And it's not, people weren't destroying their fields on purpose. They're trying to find a place to go with water. So Matt started working with the village, and he said, I'd like to help out here. I'd like to help transport people and you know, see what the needs are. And people said, well, you're going to have to do something about the mafia. He said, what can we do about the mafia? They said, well, you know, maybe if you figure out a way to make your presence here work for the village, we'll try to take care of the mafia. So Matt agreed with them, you know, which makes sense, is that when we got pickups, when we had a boat land near the village, we would pay a villager to come and do the transportation. Not a lot of money, not mafia rates, you know, 15, 20 euros, you know. Greece has an economic crisis right now. It makes sense. There's a lot of money from the NGOs flowing in, so Matt said, okay. So they blockaded the village. They drove the mafia out of the village. They wouldn't let them come down the road anymore. And the mafia went away. And mind you, the mafia wasn't just charging people. They were abducting children. They were kidnapping people. There's thousands of children who've been abducted in this crisis, especially in Europe, in Eastern Europe, and in Turkey. So at this point, that doesn't happen anymore in Lesbos. There's too many volunteers. There's too many organizations set up. So they started a group called the CK team, which is what I joined. So CK, it just stands for the Coordination of Clio, which is the village. And we operated out of a couple different villages, and we operated on these beaches where most of the beaches where we were, there's no other groups that work there. It's just us. No one was there before. We identified where these common landing points were, and we started setting up tents there. And even though it's not as busy as some of the other places, there'll be nights where, you know, we had a tent. The night I got there, we had set up a tent at this beach called Palios. And the two nights before that, 2 days in a row, we had gotten landings there. And in one of the landings, this woman had frostbite so bad that they said that she probably lost some of her toes. And when you're dealing with situations like that, an hour can make a really, really significant difference. This is that beach I'm talking about. You can't really see it very well, but... So we said, okay, if we can cut an hour out of the time that we can respond and we can have medics sleeping in a tent on the beach, let's do it. So we stayed there. Every night I was there, we didn't get a single boat. And I kept arguing at meetings, we should remove the tent at Palios. We don't get boats there. And we were about to do it. And then right after I left, a week later, on this beach, a boat sank 100 meters off the coast with 100 people in it. And my team was there because they had camped there. And Sea Watch, the rescue boat, was there because we had started coordinating. And they were able to save everyone's lives. People were in the water. Children were in the water. And they were able to respond super quickly because they had the tent there. So that was the kind of work that we did. Sometimes it was a lot of waiting, a lot of nothing. Other nights you'd have 5 boats land in a row and you'd just be dealing with hundreds and hundreds of people. So this is what the work is. You spend a lot of time, like where I was, in the busier times, like, so this is a landing at that same beach in the daytime at Palios. This is at sunrise. So that boat probably has, 45 to 50 people on it. And then our little tent is hidden back here. And that's just 2 members of my team. You can see a rubber boat from the night before, deflated, the life jackets everywhere, another rubber boat here. So this was before I came. And this just, it just happens and happens and happens and happens and happens. Usually at a beach like this, you end up spending a lot of time hanging out with the people and hearing their stories, and I'm going to talk in a minute about that. This is a morning where we had, I was camped on this other beach, and we had, I think, 2 or 3 boats that night. We had a boat of folks from Syria and Iraq, and we had a boat full of people from Afghanistan. And we woke up from the tent at like 3 in the morning, and they had already had a huge bonfire of life preservers. And we walked up to them and said hi, and we were talking to them. And some of them had been on a boat a month earlier that sank, and a bunch of people died. And these people got back on a boat and did it again. This woman had lost her kid, and she was back on the boat. And this is, like, this disrupts this narrative from Europe that's, they're just coming here because it's easy. And it's the same thing with people coming from south of the U.S. border into the U.S. And somehow they're simultaneously lazy and stealing your job, which is like a magic trick. I don't know how you do both of those at once, unless your job's really easy. And it's like, they just want to take advantage of what? Our amazing social safety net? That's why people are risking their lives in the desert with rattlesnakes and scorpions and gangs, like all these things. Come on. And you see that. You see people who's, like, we met a lot of people whose boats sank. They got arrested. They got robbed by the Turkish Coast Guard. They got robbed by the Turkish police. They got robbed by a gang. And they come back, and they do it again. And they find the money. They go work, and they get the money, and they come back because they want to get into Europe, because they want to have a different life. That's what they want, right? So we had taken a couple boats. We were just ready to go back to sleep. And then we got word that this boat with 180 people on it had come into... So it hadn't come into the harbor, it was just floating. It was just floating across the ocean. And at that lighthouse that I showed you where all the boats crash, we have a lookout point and another organization there called Lighthouse Relief. They watch the sea 24 hours a day. Every 15 minutes you do a lookout, scan the whole horizon. When I would do day shifts there, because we used to do day shifts there, I saw boats get intercepted by the Turkish Coast Guard. I watched them, one day we had a lookout there and we watched the Turkish Coast Guard spraying a rubber boat full of refugees with a hose. That happened a lot. We had multiple people who came, multiple boats where people had experienced that. Video came out recently from a British Channel 4 news of the Turkish Coast Guard trying to hit their rubber boat with a spear from another boat, trying to sink them. And then when they failed to do that because the refugees were fighting back with their life jackets, they started taking their big ship right past them and trying to throw huge waves over top of them to flip them over. And that was all on video. And they didn't stop, and they made it to Greece because they actually can't take them out of the water if they're moving. So they just said, no, we've come too far. We're not stopping. And we had that. We had a group of young people from Afghanistan who'd been sprayed with a hose. The Coast Guard kept getting in front of them. They kept going around, and they just kept going. And then 2 hours later, they were in Greece. So what happened? This boat, they saw it at night with the thermal night vision goggles. They said, we got a really big boat. It started to get closer. They called out rescue boats. And this is all coordinated through a WhatsApp group on the phone. So they called out the rescue boats. These volunteers from Spain came. They're called Proactiva. I told you about them. So Proactiva, this is them here. They, four of their people and another guy from Norway, from another team, are facing human trafficking charges right now in Greece for doing the same thing that they did this morning, which was there was a boat in distress. There was a fear that it was going to sink. They tied a line to it, and they towed it into a harbor. And they got off the boat, and they got arrested for human trafficking. They said that the boat was not in distress. It wasn't sinking. It was just in the middle of the ocean and out of fuel. But it wasn't sinking. Don't worry. They only work in Greek waters. They can't cross into Turkish waters. They cross into Turkish waters, they're in Turkey, right? But when they're in the EU, and they're EU citizens, they're allowed to do that. I mean, they're allowed to be out in the waters and helping people and whatnot. So they were saying that there is a dispute over whether or not they were in Greece. And they said, well, if we weren't in Greece, then why weren't we arrested by Turkey? Good argument. No response from the Greek government? Okay. And I met one of the guys from the Norwegian group, and he's still out there every single day, and he doesn't care that he's facing human trafficking charges. He told me stuff that I won't share here, but really, really horrifying stories from last summer that no one should ever have to see, and decisions no one should ever have to make. And he just said, like, from what I've seen, I don't care what they do to me. I'm out here. I'm gonna be out here on this boat. So this morning, this boat, 180 people, it's just floating. So they go up, Proactiva contacts it. They come up alongside it. They're trying to guide it to a safer beach. This was the goal at night. We never wanted a boat to land on a dangerous area. We always wanted to direct them to. So if where I was volunteering, my job was to not have to deal with a boat if I didn't have to, because we didn't work on safe beaches. We worked on the unsafe beaches. So they're guiding it. But no, the person driving it isn't a boat captain. They're just a refugee who was chosen as being like, well, I guess I'll try to drive the boat. And it was about to smash into a big rock. And so they barely managed to avoid it. And after that, Proactiva said, because even if with that rescue boat, if that boat sank, they might be able to save 15, 20 people. You can't save that many people. You'd have to do a bunch of different runs. So they were like, we can't risk anything happening to the boat. They tied it. They brought it to this port. They get here, and then up sails the Greek Coast Guard, screaming, flipping out. You don't have jurisdiction here. You have to cut that rope. Like threatening them with arrest. You know, this is my jurisdiction. Some turf stuff, right? And we're literally, like, the boat is out in the harbor and on the beach, because we had like an hour's notice. There's all these volunteers there. We've got vans. We're ready to drive people to the Doctors Without Borders camp. Everything's set up. And then they stop the boat in the harbor. Greek Coast Guard is yelling at the Spanish lifeguards. They're yelling back. They're like, you don't know what you're doing. We're the ones who save people's lives here. You just watch. Get out of our way. And then finally, they threaten enough, and the Spanish lifeguards cut the rope, and they say, fine, you do it. So the Greek Coast Guard ties a rope to it, and they try to turn the boat around, and they're going to pull it somewhere else, like an hour's drive south to the capital. And the boat starts rocking back and forth really violently. So they cut the rope. So then the boat's just sitting there. Up sails, you know, the rescue boat from the anarchist camp called Platanos, the German Sea Watch group, Refugee Rescue's lifeboat comes up. All these rescue boats are there. You've got the Portuguese police through Frontex, you've got the Greek Coast Guard, and they're all just sitting around this boat, and it's going nowhere. And then this Greek fisherman in this little fishing boat sails up, ties a rope to it, pulls it to the port, and then just sails off. And he's like, there, boat's at the port. This is like the spirit of Greece right now. No one, you know, people look at things like that and they go, well, that's dumb. I don't care if it's legal or not. I'll bring it to the port. So then we offloaded everyone. On this boat, we had people from basically every country that's represented in the refugee crisis on this boat. We had people from Nigeria. We had people from Eritrea, Somalia. We had people from Algeria. We had people from Palestine, Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, all sorts of people on this boat. And that's something to note, right? So talk about this for a minute. These folks were Kurdish people from Syria. That's the Spanish lifeguards there. But let's get into the stories of. So there's this, you know, the common story is, you know, this is like the Syrian refugee crisis, and Syria is, the lead, the world. They have the highest amount of refugees in the world right now, fleeing. The second largest is Afghanistan. This is not talked about in the media. I mostly met Afghan people. Why don't they talk about that in the media? Oh, I don't know, because it's our responsibility. Syria, you can at least, you know, and granted, there's a truth in it. Like, the biggest killer in Syria is the government of Syria. It's Assad. It's not ISIS, right? ISIS is bad, sure. But it's easy, because you can blame that on, like, Russia and other people. Afghanistan, you can't point the finger in many other places. At least the finger of responsibility. How come we've been at war there for 15 years and this is the country with the second largest amount of refugees in the world fleeing? These folks were from Kurdistan. Some of the guys in this sort of group had been fighters in what's called the YPG, which is the Kurdish Self-Defense Forces, who've been battling ISIS. Very radical group. You had people... I had people from the Iraqi Kurdish Peshmerga fighters. I had people from we had people from Syria and Afghanistan who were just like whose village had been bombed by some group, right? I had I met a guy on the ferry, a young kid from Syria, and the Syrian government had bombed his house during breakfast, and he had his whole head was cut open and stuff. And he was coming with his entire family. He was traveling with 45 people. And they agreed to stick together. And his father was already in Germany. He had gone to Germany a year before. So this is happening with a lot of these refugees too, right? Last year, Germany said, you can come to Germany. Sweden said, you can come to Sweden. So people's father went. People's husband went. Their son went. You know, usually a male from the family. Went ahead. They went first. They tried to find a job. Of course, a year later, his father was still living in a refugee camp in Germany. And this is an Arab Syrian. This is supposed to be like, Arab Syrians are supposed to have like a gold ticket in Germany. Like, you're from Syria, welcome to Germany, you're in. A year later, he's still in a refugee camp, still can't find a job. Here comes his entire family, extended family, and he's supposed to have gotten things figured out for them. Now you've got people who are coming to Greece, like the maybe, 250 people who arrived in Lesbos last night. And guess what? They're going to get deported to Turkey because of this new law. And their family members might be already in Europe. They might have come last year to try to get things ready for the family, to try to make enough money to buy them a journey. So where does that come from, right? I could keep going on about where are these people from, right? We had people from the Dominican Republic the other night come to Lesbos from Turkey. I don't know why they were in Turkey, but I had heard a rumor when I was there that there were some people from Cuba that came, and I was like, yeah, I doubt it. And now that people I actually know said, yeah, there are Dominicans, I said, maybe there were Cubans. Okay. It's a much shorter boat ride than Cuba to Florida. I'll just go through... probably be done with the pictures for a bit. This is one of our hidden campsites. So this is a beach. This is our tent here. The thing about a beach like this, real quick, is that there's two main types of boats that come in. There's the boats without smugglers and the boats with smugglers, right? The boats without smugglers just come wherever they're going. If they're the rubber boat, it's a pretty easy to use engine. You can steer yourself, you know. The other boats with the smuggler on board, sometimes it's like a really, really fast-moving speedboat. This beach, we had the same boat come four times in a night, 45 minutes front to Turkey, back and forth, boom, 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 just kept picking up people. and dropping them off. And those people pay like $2,500 a head for that boat ride. They always dropped them in the exact same part of the beach. It was like actually really convenient. I didn't consider those people to be like bad smugglers, because when they're on the boat, they're going to be safe. They're actually getting people there quickly and safely, and that's the best you can ask for. The ones without the smuggler on board, anything, it doesn't matter. If those people die, it doesn't matter. The smuggler makes money. They already paid. It doesn't matter. These guys, at least we respected that they were putting themselves in the dangerous situation as well. But we would still hide out. We didn't want them to see us. We didn't want to interact with them. We don't need to do that. They don't need to see us and get freaked out. And you know, if they saw, even we didn't even use lamps on the headlamps on this beach. You just had to get used to walking in the dark, because if the smuggler boat is coming in and he sees a cell phone light or a headlamp, he doesn't know who that is. He doesn't know if that's a police or not. He could get arrested for this. He's human trafficking, technically. So he's going to turn, and he's going to go drop these people off around the corner on these cliffs. Now we're going to have people on the edge of a cliff, and we're going to have to figure out how to get them out of there. We had a night where people got dropped off at the edge of this cliff, and there was no roads. It took our team like 30 minutes walking through thorn bushes to find them. And they get there, and not only are at the bottom of a cliff, one of the guys is in a wheelchair. And so they're like, okay, what do we do now? But we called in boats, and it took a long time, but, you know, we took people. So, beyond the wars, right? Like, that's always that's like the Middle East, right? It's all war. It must be all war. These people all must be fleeing war. No, not only that. Another significant factor from this is people fleeing political persecution from the Arab Spring, you know? So I met a lot of people who were revolutionaries, who were Syrian revolutionaries. They tried to overthrow a dictatorship, one of the strongest dictatorships in the world. And now they're dealing with the repercussions of it, right? There were people who were in like a village in Afghanistan who stood up to the Taliban. And they're getting driven out. We had people, and it's not just, you know, yeah, the civil war in Syria is awful. And when you look at the numbers testify to that. 11% of the population is either dead or injured. 22% of the population has fled the country or is dead. That doesn't just happen just because there's a low-level war. That happens in a really, really horrible situation. Now you've got, in Afghanistan, not only do you still have American troops and mercenaries running around, you still have the Taliban, you still have the Afghan government, which is basically another version of the Taliban, but they're the good guys. They're all heroin traffickers. The Afghan government a lot more so than the Taliban. Even according to the UN's data, the Taliban only controls like 3% of the heroin industry. The rest is controlled by other people. Then you've got ISIS, who've come into Afghanistan to try to claim like that they're the new game in town. So they're now fighting a war against the Taliban in southeastern Afghanistan. So we had people who come from there who were like, yeah, we're fleeing. ISIS and the Taliban are fighting each other in our villages, you know? And then we had people who'd been attacked by U.S. drone bombings and things like this in the same region. So it's not a unified thing. It's not that everyone's fleeing one bad guy or another. It's just, it's all these situations, and they're all coalescing. The other thing that's coalescing right now, so I want to get into now talking about the EU policy, and then I want to talk about the U.S. and our role, and our role not as a government, but as people in the U.S., like I said earlier, there's this rise of the far right in Europe, and it did start before the refugee crisis. It has been exacerbated by the refugee crisis. And so you've got, especially in Northern Europe and in Eastern Europe, right-wing parties in government, furthest right-wing party in the German political scene, getting seats in parliament for the first time since World War II, right? You've got a neo-Nazi party. I call it a neo-Nazi party. They don't say that they're a neo-Nazi party. There's a neo-Nazi party in Sweden. It's now the third largest political party in Sweden. Good old neutral Sweden. Why? Because Sweden said Syrian refugees could come there. So a bunch of people came. Sweden's taken in more people per capita than any other country in Europe. And now there's a backlash from the right wing. same in Finland, in Norway, in the Czech Republic, in Hungary, in Bulgaria, in Greece, in Austria, the right in France. The right wing has a lot of power. And they also, not only do they gain more power from the refugee crisis, every time that ISIS does a terrorist attack in Europe, the right wing grows from it. The right wing benefits from it. They become more powerful. So that's why some of the conspiratorial-minded people think that they're all working together. But at least they have common interests, which is not surprising, because they're both far right-wing movements. So the far right has risen, and what happens now is people started closing their borders. So Austria, even though they're very close allies with Germany, and Germany was saying, let the refugees come here, Austria closed their border, Serbia closed their border, and everyone was pointing north saying, well, Austria's border's closed, so, you know, Austria borders Serbia, and, you know, well, if their border's closed, then we're just going to get stuck with all these people, so we're going to close our border. So then Macedonia said, okay, well, then we're going to close our border, because we don't want to get stuck with all these people. And Greece can't close their border, because they have, like, 75 islands or whatever. What's happened now is there's now, like, I think at this point now, maybe 60,000 refugees stuck in Greece. Greece, which is the center of the European economic crisis and is now the center of the refugee crisis as well. But this is coming out of it's not just this rise of the right wing, it's also that there's a political crisis in the EU. There's people who want to leave the EU, they want to leave the euro, because they're the wealthier countries. That's why this is happening mostly in the north, in the wealthier countries, even in Switzerland, right? Sweden, Norway, you know, Finland, right? Germany, these are places with money. So these opposition, these far-right parties, they want to leave the Eurozone. They're like, why is our money going to these other people? Southern Europe's been super cool about it for the most part. Portugal said people could come there. Spain tried to stop this new EU deal from going into effect. Greece is like tethered to Germany because of their debt crisis, so they do anything Germany wants. Because Greece supposedly has like a far-left government, and they just today passed the law required to deport people back to Turkey. And Turkey's already started deporting people back to Syria and Afghanistan, which is illegal. It's against international law. So the fact that the EU is participating in that knowingly is actually against international law. So let's talk about that. So this EU deal came. Germany was having an election. Merkel, who's from the center-right Christian Democrat Party, she was worried, her party was worried that they were going to lose votes to the far right, so they had to solve the refugee crisis really, really quickly, right? And things were getting really dire. They closed the Macedonian border. So basically all these little countries, Macedonia, Serbia, pressured the big powerhouse economies of Europe to do something about it. So did Turkey. Turkey kept threatening, like, we'll open the floodgate into Europe, you know, we'll flood Europe with refugees and destroy Europe and all these things. This is the kind of language they're using. Why? Because they want money from the EU, and they're getting it now. They're getting $3 billion. They're going to get another $3 billion probably. They also, Turkey's in a pretty much full-blown war in the southeast of Turkey, in the Kurdish areas, and it's barely in the news. It's really, really vicious. It's a very, very real war. Cutting power lines, bombing cities, bulldozing houses, all of this. Shooting demonstrators, all of it. They want the EU to not say anything about it. They want political protection. So they said, well, you know, we could open the floodgate, or we could figure something out, and you could be kind of hush-hush about this, and give us $3 billion, and give us visas for all of our citizens, etc. So that's what's happening. There's a lot of, like, blackmail and gambling going on. So anyways, the EU needs to do something. Germany's having an election, you know, whatever. People are worried that the far right is gonna take power, even from the established right wing. They try to hurry through this agreement. People are getting stuck at the Macedonian border. They're breaking the border down with logs. They're fighting with the police and the military there because they're desperate. They want to get out of there. So they pass this deal, which took it. It's even once they announced it took a month to come into effect because there was a lot of problems with it. At the end of it, here's what came out. So as of last Sunday, I think it was March 19th it went into effect, the anniversary of the U.S. invasion of Iraq, ironically, and of the the same day that the NATO invaded Libya. They passed this agreement saying, okay, anyone who arrives after this day, after March 19th, gets deported to Turkey. No one else comes into Europe. It doesn't matter where you're from. It doesn't matter if you're from Syria. It doesn't matter anything. You go back to Turkey. It doesn't matter if you have a legitimate case for asylum. If you come with a picture of someone putting a gun to your head, you get deported back to Turkey. And then you're in Turkey. The other side of that is that Turkey's then supposed to create a system for actual cases of asylum for legitimate refugees. And they haven't done that. Greece hasn't done it. There's no infrastructure for it. But they're already starting the deportations. So the worst part of the policy is going into effect without the parts that might actually benefit people eventually. Then there's this bizarre, absolutely mind-boggling part of the agreement, which says, okay, for every Syrian that we pick up in Greece, meaning now when they come to a beach like this beach, Theodorus, where we had a bunch of landings this week, actually, my team took, when they land there, we used to drive them up to our facility that we helped operate, this abandoned cheese factory. We give them tea and blankets, talk to them, whatever, hang out. And then a bus would come and take them to the Doctors Without Borders camp. They would get medical treatment there. There'd be translators. There'd be food. People would get a better understanding of like what their journey's going to look like. You know, they could use the internet, all of this stuff. Then they'd take a bus down to another camp called Moria, which was looked like a prison at the time, but was actually just voluntary. And then they go to the port. They get on a ferry. They go to Athens. So now with the new policy, we drive them to the center of town, and we tell them good luck, because we aren't involved with the rest of the process anymore. Why? Because they turned Moria, the camp, into a prison. It's no longer voluntary. It's controlled by the military and the police. Every NGO that worked there pulled out of it, which is surprising, because NGOs don't normally get involved in politics. Doctors Without Borders said, we can't work here. Oxfam said that. Save the Children pulled out. Even the UN's High Commission on Refugees pulled out. So the EU passed an agreement that the UN won't even deal with. And all of them say, this is probably against international law, and it's a violation of human rights, what you're doing, and it's absolutely wrong. We do not get involved in deportations. We are involved in humanitarian work. You're not doing humanitarian work. We won't be involved. So they said, good luck running the shelter. Good luck finding food for all these people, but we can't do it. And a lot of us really appreciated that. And I guarantee you, if you went and talked to the refugees, a lot of people would say, no, we're glad they did that, because someone needs to stand with us. Something needs to change. We can't be like, oh, but what if people go one night without blankets? You know what? They're gonna survive it, because they've survived a long journey. They want something to change. Otherwise, they're just going to get deported. So this is what's happened. So then they said, okay, so there, you know, there's NATO boats out in the water now, and there's all these police boats and everything. We still have boats out there. The volunteers are out there saving lives, helping guide boats to safe beaches. But now they say for every Syrian that we pick up and deport back to Turkey, we'll take a different Syrian who's in Turkey, who's legitimate, and we'll bring them into Europe as a refugee. How they came up with that, I have no idea. I don't know if it was like a joke that became a reality, or if it was like they were drunk by that point in the meeting, or something happened, but literally, the EU passed this policy, Syrian for a Syrian. So in order for a Syrian refugee, quote, legitimate Syrian refugee, to come to Europe from Turkey, a different Syrian has to pay $1,500 to $3,000 to a smuggler who Europe says they're trying to stop the smugglers, and this new plan is going to stop the smugglers. So you're paying the smuggler, he's bringing you, you're risking your life on a boat, then you're getting arrested, then you're getting processed and held for a week or two, then you're getting deported, and then another Syrian can come, but not you, a different person. So that's the new European deal, and then of course Turkey's getting all this money from it. Does anybody have any questions before I talk about solidarity and
Are they deporting back to Turkey? I mean, back to Syria?
Europe is not, but Turkey is.
That's what I meant. Like, so the legitimate Syrian that you talked about goes to Europe, but the person who's picked up by the police and put in this process is actually actively being deported by Turkey to Syria? Is that really happening?
Not every single person.
But it is happening.
Yeah, in the last few days there's been multiple news stories saying there's documented cases recently of Turkey deporting people to Syria and to Afghanistan. But guess what? Turkey's not like a full member of the EU, so they don't have to follow that rule. But if the EU is in a legal agreement with a country that's doing that,
You're using the word refugee. Mm. And the news here, they often call them migrants.
Yeah.
Can you kind of talk about the language? And
that's very important.
The implications of the language?
Yes. Yeah. No, I this is something that is a very important distinction in Europe, especially like in the left-wing movements and the anarchists and the leftist activist scenes, is a couple years ago, they really started to just use the word refugee. And eventually that's kind of become not the mainstream term, but one of them. And it's very interesting to me because we don't use the term refugee in the U.S. for anyone coming from south of the U.S., except for Cuba. Cubans are refugees. Everyone else is not a refugee. They're an economic migrant. They're an immigrant. We don't even say economic migrant. They're an illegal immigrant, right? Or they're just undocumented, which means they're missing something. The term refugee is used by most people that I interacted with in Europe to refer to anybody that's coming. They said, look, if somebody's risking their life on the ocean, then they've got a legitimate case for wanting to leave their home and coming somewhere else. And people have the right to travel, people should have the right to go places and try to make a living there. That is a lot harder with European nationalists even than it is with Americans. Because at least with American nationalists, patriotic Americans, you could argue, hey, isn't like most people in this country not from here? Didn't your white ancestor come from Europe looking for a job, just like these people are? And you can kind of play that. In Europe, you can't. You're like, I don't know where you came from, German dude. I don't know how long Germany's even existed. I don't know your cultural history, where your people came from. So they have a much stronger case for saying, like, no, this is like where our people are from, and blah, blah, blah. You even hear it when you watch like a soccer matches in Europe. They won't just say, you know, oh, good goal by the Frenchman. They'll say, good goal by the Frenchman of Algerian origin. You know, like that's a necessary thing to add to the Frenchman who just scored the goal. Is that, oh, and he's from Algeria, by the way. He's not French. He's Algerian French. But yeah, so that was a political decision that was made by people involved in this work. And I think it's very important that we recognize, like in the US, like, okay, so Mexico, right? For a couple years there, Mexico was more dangerous than Iraq. But Mexicans weren't considered refugees. They're just considered migrants or immigrants or whatever. But more people were dying in northern Mexico than were dying in Iraq for, I think, a good 3 years. You know, Honduras has the most dangerous city in the world outside of Syria. They're not considered refugees. We helped overthrow their government in 2009. It became one of the most violent countries in the world. They're not refugees. El Salvador, they're not refugees. Guatemala, not refugees. So, you know, and then there's the rest of the Caribbean. But with all their history, with all the conflicts that have been there, we still don't use that term. And I think we should. But this is where we start talking about that, right? So what happened in the 70s and 80s during the civil wars in Central America? You know, the U.S. was funding different sides of these civil wars, proxy wars, fighting communism in Nicaragua, all these things. And we had over 1 million refugees from those wars enter the U.S. And a huge movement formed around it. There was a whole illegal network of people from the church who smuggled people in. They even worked with churches in Mexico to smuggle people in. to know the roots. They hid people. They found people housing. They hid them in their churches. They got city councils to pass things saying that they wouldn't turn people, Central American refugees, over to the police, that they would protect them. And of course, in Central America, the U.S. involvement was pretty much universal, right? It was pretty much everywhere. In this situation, currently, the U.S. is definitely involved. There's places where the U.S. might not be involved, but probably is involved, because we are the global superpower, and we tend to have our hands in things. I also don't want to overdo our role, right? I got criticized by a friend of mine last week saying I was giving the U.S. too much responsibility for Syria, and I wasn't being hard enough on the government of Syria. And I was like, okay, that's fair. I respect that. Because she's Syrian, right? And she knows. And most of the Syrians you meet are going to tell you that. So I don't want to, there's this tendency of some of the people on the political left who think more conspiratorially or still have like this nostalgia for like the good days in the 70s when Saddam Hussein was like a freedom fighter or whatever. But Assad is awful. The government of Syria is awful. The stories I've heard from refugees are horrible, awful. Total police state. You know, like during the revolution when they were out in the protests, my friend said, he's a Syrian refugee, he said that he didn't smell tear gas until he was in Turkey during the second, the anniversary of the uprising in Gezi Park. And I was like, they didn't tear gas you in Syria? He said, no, they just shoot at you. And they just start shooting into the demonstration. And he's like, I can run from bullets. I don't know how to run from tear gas. Okay. But what is the U.S. role in the Syrian war? And also, I don't want to just focus on Syria, right? Remember Afghanistan. Remember Iraq is the third largest population group entering Europe. We don't need to talk about Iraq because we know what we've done there. But in Syria, last year, the U.S. gave $1.5 billion in aid to rebel groups in Syria fighting in the civil war. That's a lot of money. Like, that rivals the amount of money that we give, like, the Egyptian military every year, or Israel. $1.5 billion. In the same year, last year, how many Syrian refugees did we bring into the U.S.? 1,700 total. 1,700 out of the 8 million. So we're doing our part, you know? This year, they cut the public budget, so it's two budgets. It's the CIA budget, which is $1 billion, and it's the congressional budget, which is $500 million. They cut the congressional one this year, partly because of news stories like the one that came out in the Chicago Tribune earlier this week, or last week, where it was like, CIA-funded rebel faction is fighting Pentagon-funded rebel faction in Syria, gun to gun, with American weapons. And not just American, but Saudi Arabia, Qatar, the United Arab Emirates, Turkey, all these groups are funding different parts of the civil war. So this year, as of 2 weeks ago, we had taken in 955 Syrian refugees into the U.S. And our goal this year, according to Obama, was 10,000. Clearly, it's not going to happen. Maybe they'll hit 3,000. But we also have, you know, what happened? Shooting in San Bernardino. Suddenly Donald Trump blows up, wants to ban Syrian refugees from the U.S. The governor of Maryland, my home, first governor in the country to say, yeah, I agree. I want to ban Syrian refugees from resettling in my state. You know, people in my family were agreeing with it. Suddenly this became, oh yeah, it doesn't matter if none of the people are from Syria. Like, anyone who's been involved in any terrorist attack in the U.S. since 9/11, there's no Syrians involved. None of these people were refugees. That doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if the two of the three San Bernardino shooters were born in Illinois. It doesn't matter. Syrian refugee. That sounds good. Do it. It's believable. Just like in Europe. But, so, meanwhile, we're funding different sides in the civil war. We're exacerbating the conflict. We have political goals in Syria. And we're not doing our part at home. So, I don't want to talk too much longer. But the message I'm trying to bring to people in writing and in my presentations is about asking these questions. So you've seen what Europe's doing. This is just some of it. I didn't even show you the people who try to storm the English Channel tunnel out of the Calais camp in France. The people who are blockading train stations in London, where they do deportations. The refugees doing hunger strikes outside of their camps in the Netherlands, joined by local activists, doing marches through the centers of the cities in the Netherlands, occupying public squares in Belgium and the Netherlands. There was an abandoned church that Iraqi refugees occupied in the Netherlands and turned it into an organizing social center. There was in Germany, there was refugees, Syrian refugees, and others squatting buildings to live in. Neo-Nazis were burning them down. There's been tons of refugee centers burned down in Sweden. There's been people in the streets battling with these fascists who are doing it all over Europe. There's people in the train stations just handing out water, just going around with food and water for the people sleeping everywhere. There's doctors in Athens who go down to the port where there's just thousands and thousands and thousands of refugees everywhere, sleeping in under anything that can guard you from the rain, sleeping out on the sidewalks, people sleeping in the fields. This is all over the place, right? And so the thing I'm bringing back is, like, what more can we be doing in the U.S. given our responsibility in the situation, right? Greece didn't invade Iraq. The U.S. did. Greece isn't giving $1.5 billion a year to the Syrian conflict. We are. And I don't have, like, solid ideas because it's new. You can't do what they did in the 80s because they had a border in the 80s. You could smuggle people across it. You can't smuggle people here from Iraq. Good luck, right? But there's organizations that are working to get people here, to help people do their paperwork. There's organizations helping get people here on student visas. But there's also this question of what more can we do besides just the official legal process? Because they control the legal process. It's going to be really slow. You can work so hard doing that, and it's going to be really slow. And the bullet points that me and my group kind of worked out was, going over there, if you or anyone you know has any interest in going and being involved, go over for a month. Go get involved on the Macedonian border. Go to the northern France, to Calais. Go to Turkey. Go to Jordan. Go to Lebanon. Volunteer. Get to know the situation. Get to understand, like, the depth of it, how big of a deal it is. In the 80s, they sent lots and lots and lots of people to Nicaragua and to El Salvador so that was going to last for decades, that consciousness. And some of those organizations are still around, right? I really feel like people like me who came out of the anti-war movement, we sort of failed in getting to understand the cultures of these places that we were at war with, or even their basic histories. It was just like George Bush and his bombs, and that was what we thought about. We didn't think about, well, who are the Iraqis? What's their issues? What are they dealing with? So the other side of this is movement solidarity, right? Like building consciousness, doing events, doing reading groups, talking to people about the political movements in these places. There's plenty of material recently. Like there's a new book called I think it's called Burning Country about Syria, about interview with revolutionaries in Syria. This woman, Layla Shami, is touring with it in April in the U.S. There's a new book called Against All Odds, which my friend Ali Issa just published. It's the interviews with social movement participants in Iraq. There's stuff like this, so we can start expressing solidarity. There's tens of thousands of political prisoners in Egypt right now, stemming from the revolution. Amnesty's been keeping track of some of that. There's a group called the Egypt Solidarity Project. And then there's also, like, we could also... could be getting in touch with some of the organizations in Europe and finding out, what do they need? Do they need help? Do they need fundraising? Is there any materials that they need? Do they need volunteers? Could we help? You know, whatever. And then the fourth one, which is the biggest and the hardest one, right? The right wing is basically built a movement demanding that refugees be kept out of the U.S. How do we build one that's demanding the opposite? How do we put actual political pressure on saying, no, we're not doing enough for these countries that we've invaded or where we're funding proxy wars? Yes, the U.S. does take more refugees than any other country in the world, but not from the countries it's invaded, right? So how do we open that door more? How do we put that pressure on? They've had some marches. They had a march in Kansas City a few months ago called Bring Them Here, you know, demanding that the U.S. refugee policies towards these countries change. Those are like, that would be... my understanding of like applying the European movements to the U.S. Those are some of the options, but there's other options. But I want to encourage you all to like put it on your mind, talk to people about it. If you're involved with refugees locally, or you're involved in an organization that's doing work around the affected regions of the crisis, think about telling more people about the work that you're doing, reaching out to people, trying to work with other organizations. In Baltimore, we have Catholic Relief Services, we have the International Rescue Committee, we have Lutheran Relief Services, but they don't have like coordinated meetings together to talk about anything. And then there's local activists and local Arab activists, and they're not really, so right now we're trying to build a bit of a coalition, and we're trying to like get those groups in the same room to share, you know, resources and understandings of what's happening. With the whopping total, we're one of like the main refugee resettlement cities, Baltimore, for Syrians, and we have 32 Syrian refugees who've been resettled in Baltimore. And we had a news story last year that said, Baltimore braces for influx of Syrian refugees. And it was 25 people. This is the kind of crap that we're dealing with. But anyways, that's my talk. But if I would wanted to open it if anyone wants for questions or comments or anything like that.
I'm just curious, like, what was people's reaction when Syriza said okay to that law? Like, have they just, people just given up on them as any kind of oppositional, because they have to do everything Germany says, or?
Yes, like, Syriza, so if people don't know, Syriza was elected as, like, the far left-wing government of Greece, and they ran on 100% anti-austerity platform, and then somehow they ended up doing the exact opposite of that, if you can believe it or not, a politician doing the exact opposite of what they said they were going to do. But so they agreed to even worse austerity than they had before, all these stipulations from Germany, and they agreed to all of it. And now they just do whatever Germany asks, anything. So Germany says, hey, will you deport people? Will you pass a law in your parliament? Like Greece is editing their own internal laws to reflect the EU-Turkey decision about the refugees. And this is a far-left government. The whole country had a referendum against the austerity measures, and then the government ignored the referendum and went ahead and passed them. They thought it was going to fail. They didn't realize it was going to succeed. Yeah, almost everyone I talked to who are Syriza voters were just like, politicians, this is what they do.
But weren't they not politicians before? I mean, wasn't it, I don't know that much about it, but weren't they, like, really grounded people before?
I mean, the one guy that I know from...
And
from,
I'm a politician, by the way.
The one guy I know from who was in Syriza, who I think really kept his dignity, is Varoufakis, who was the finance minister. And he was really fighting Germany in the negotiations. And when they agreed to when the government turned its back on the people in the referendum and went ahead and pushed the austerity, Varoufakis resigned and left the party. Or he left a seat in government. I think a lot of people respected that. I asked people about Varoufakis and they said, no, Varoufakis is good. But my understanding is that Syriza didn't grow out of, like, you know, it's not like Podemos in Spain that really grew out of the square in 2011. Syriza existed before, and from what people have told me, like, people in the politics in Greece, like, all come out of, like, this sort of, like, a program that you're on for a long time. Almost like an academy or something. Like, people come out of the same sort of circles. I don't understand exactly what that means, but... Like Cyprus has no like street cred. No one's like, oh yeah, but back in the day, no, they're just like, yeah, he's just a politician that came out and suddenly became the you know, head of the party. And but the shame is that people did have faith in Syriza. They did. And people who didn't even vote, even like really, really far left and anarchists were out voting for Syriza. A lot of anarchists didn't, of course, but I mean, Greece is a really polarized country, and it's really visceral there. I mean, you really see it, and Syriza like just further disenchanted people. And the risk was, from what I understand, from one of the arguments was, well, if if they, even though Greeks were voting against their own economic interests on purpose, knowing that the vote against the austerity might get them kicked out of the Eurozone and might cause a further crisis for them, they were like willing to risk that and willing to deal with it to get the situation over with and move on. From what I understand, some people said the government did the right thing because if they had caused a further economic crisis, the Golden Dawn would have exploited it and grown, and then if that government had fallen, Greece could have a neo-Nazi government. On the other side of it, other people say, well, the fact that they've disenchanted all their people is going to empower the right wing, because they're about as far left as you could get, and they failed, you know? So, lots of bitterness against Syriza. But people would still defend them from, like, a right-wing coup, you know? Like, the Union still, you know, are out marching and stuff, and would be defending Syriza, but not without harsh criticism, for sure. Yeah. Any other questions, y'all, or...?
Is there, have there been attacks of against the refugees by, you know, right-wing groups and, you know, what I would say, like, the KKK here, but groups over there? And, you know, are there, is there protection or a way of trying to keep them out of the group, out of there? Also, I, two things. One thing, the other thing I was hearing about the fact that, like, Eric Prince was trying to get some stuff going there as far as controlling the refugees. I don't know if there's other mercenary groups that have sprung up trying to deal with the refugee problem. And wondering about that.
I don't know anything about Blackwater or whatever they're called now in Eric Prince. I don't know anything about the mercenary stuff there. The only security forces I interacted with were European, Frontex, which is like Europe's border patrol, and the Greek police, the Greek Coast Guard, the Greek military. In terms of the former question, yeah, like, there's definitely been attacks. There hasn't been a lot in Greece. The Golden Dawn used to just walk through the market, flipping over refugees' stalls, asking people for their papers, attacking people. This is the neo-Nazis. The one thing that Syriza did, which is good, is like they further criminalized the Golden Dawn. They put some of their parliament members in prison because they're freaking neo-Nazis. And they kind of cracked down on them a little bit. But further up the road, I mean, there's right-wing fascist attacks on the Kale camp. There's been a lot of them recently. In Germany, in Hamburg, there was a series of arson attacks. In Dresden and Leipzig, there's been neo-Nazi riots against the refugees. But, like, it's kind of like the Ku Klux Klan, right? Like, they wouldn't actually come into the city, right? Because they would just get destroyed. So they, like, stick to, like, safer battles, like fighting leftists. So the Nazis in Europe, like, they talk all this stuff, but they mostly just fight, like, the leftists and the anti-fascists. They don't actually try to go into the community. In Greece, they do because they're really powerful. Or, like, in Bulgaria or places like this. But, you know, like, you don't see that happening, like, in Paris. Because if Nazis went to the suburbs of Paris and tried to start a fight, they'd get rocked. But it has been happening in some of these other places, in the Czech Republic as well. I mean, there's been, like, pogroms in the Czech Republic where they've been trying to drive people out of communities, make them close their businesses through the threat of violence. And then there was also, I mean, there's been attacks by members of the Golden Dawn on refugees in Greece in the last year, but not like a, not in like an organized fashion. But there have been attacks as well, yeah. Questions, comments, anything?
So one thing that, like, I know about Europe, being from Europe, is that, like, what we see now as a crisis actually happened, like, way before, like, how it was arranged in Europe, how to deal with refugees, with, like, this Dublin agreement, mm-hmm. is actually, it was a failure made 10 years before, so, like, it was everyone who dealt with it knew, like, if there's something like this happening any time, then it will just, like, break down. But also, I think that the general strategy seems to be, like, to keep everything that happens, the bad things, people dying, people drowning in the sea, like, as far away as we can from those who, I don't know, elect the politicians or something. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it, like, before it was, like, with the African, the northern border, people trying to cross it, and so many people drowning, and, mm-hmm. like, a year, 2 years ago. So it happened, like, all the time, and, yes.
Yeah, last year, the 3,700 people died last year crossing into Europe, and 3,000 of them were in the Mediterranean, in the Libya-Italy crossing, not in Greece. Far fewer people make that journey, and far more die, which means it's, like, exponentially more dangerous. And that's part of the situation now with this new EU policy with Turkey, is that they even admitted when they were signing the agreement, this is probably going to cause more people to try to come from Northern Africa on boats, on much more dangerous boats. People ride rubber boats across that huge strait. And then they also said they were worried that if they don't figure something out with Greece soon, that some of the 50, 60,000 people stuck in Greece are going to start getting smuggled through Albania on a boat again into Italy to try to get out through Italy. The Albanian mafia is already involved in the smuggling from Turkey, so it makes sense that they could do it in Albania as well. But yeah, and that's the irony of it, right, is that there's, like, Europe, some countries in Europe could legitimately say, you know, from their perspective, I don't have anything to do with these situations, why should I have to bear the burden of it, right? Whereas other European countries are like, oh, why do we? Well, because you're involved in the war, because you helped invade that country, because you're in NATO, or you went in with the US, or you did X, Y, and Z. Where's your money go? Are you allies with Saudi Arabia? Then yes, you have responsibility here. Are you giving political cover for governments that are involved in this war? You do have a responsibility. But when you zoom out from it, it's absolutely true. It's like, Europe and the U.S., they want to keep the refugee crisis in the Middle East where it's not a crisis for the Western world. And it's almost, at this point, it's almost like an uncontrollable flow, and Europe knows that. And when I zoom out from it, that's what I see. I say, oh, look, that's ironic. These are the countries you colonized after the First World War, and now you have to deal with it. Now you have to, like, your culture has to change now. And that's the battle. That's like, we have the sort of Trump-Sanders divide in the U.S. right now, two very different versions of life expressed, and that's going on also in Europe, two very different realities. There's a Europe that wants to stay the way they were and be ethnically homogenous and whatever, and in their little zone and whatever, and then there's the people who are saying, no, let all these people in, our culture will change in response. This is, we all live on the planet, we're all part of these situations. These countries had to change when you invaded, when Britain invaded, when Germany and Italy invaded. These countries had to change. That's why they all speak English or French or whatever. So now it's your turn, Europe. That's, you know. Anyways. Any other comments? Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question. And I came as a refugee in America. So my question is actually part of America as well as EU actually working in deportation of refugees from Europe to whatever they are taking them and actually bringing more other, kind of repressing one to another, compared to America saying, oh, we're not taking some refugees, but we're giving out visas to people to come in here, the same countries. What would you think about that? What would be the reaction to you based on your experience?
If we were bringing people in on visas, you mean?
Because I know in 2014, USA gave almost 30-something visas to 30,000 to Syria and Iraq. Mm. But now they are like, no, we're not taking refugees in, even if they are refugees, but they are still giving visas, whatever like that. Mm. Students visas, travel visas, like tourists and stuff like that. And those are actually, for me, I consider those people as the highest risk to the country, more than refugees who go through the screening, mm-hmm. interviews, mm-hmm. CIS, FBI involved, and stuff like that. So compared to what actually AU is doing, deporting people who are actually running, trying to get to safety place, and actually trying to bring other people who are saying, oh, we are legally refugees. So it's kind of switching people, dangerous, I may say like danger, more dangerous risk people to actually the people who are looking for safety. What would be your kind of reaction to that kind of balance of USA and AU policies there?
I mean, I definitely respect, like Sweden and Germany, I respected, that's something I respected about their policies, is that they just said, if you come here, we'll take care of you, you'll be safe, right? When there's a war of that magnitude, I think that's a human reaction, and that's how people should react. They should say, if your neighbor's house is on fire, you invite them in yours. You don't say like, no, I don't know why your house is on fire, I don't know if you started the fire, stay out there. No, you say, come on, we'll figure it out. There's this, I think the worst piece of like rhetoric, this mythology that's been created from this crisis is about the danger, right? This is something the right wing has just thrown in everyone's faces in Europe, in the US. Oh, this is dangerous, we don't know who these people are. Like you pointed out, like Syrian refugees go through like 13 federal bodies of screenings to come here as a refugee. They get interviewed by everybody, scrutinized, background check, all this stuff. 13 federal agencies per person. And meanwhile, there's no statistics that justify that level of fear, right? You could go, I mean, you could look at the actual statistics that show that, what, 91% of terrorist attacks in the last however many years have been committed by white Americans. Right-wing abortion clinic bombers, racial hate groups, leftists in the 70s. But this is like, and like the even like the Brussels attacks, you know? Like, not refugees, not Syrians, doesn't matter. The visa thing, yeah, I mean, like, I feel like if you're, it's interesting to me because if you're giving somebody a visa, it's either because you trust them or because you're assuming that they're just gonna stay, right? I have to read about that more. I don't know how many people who come in on a visa from a like place like Syria, how many of them stay, how many of them actually leave eventually. I don't know. But there's also this idea that, right, that like, okay, some of these people definitely, like, they're coming to Europe and they want to stay in Europe. They just want to live in Europe now. They want to get whatever that was behind them. A lot of people who come, they'd be like, yeah, I'm from Iraq. Iraq is over. This is what they would say. Iraq's over. It's gone. It's done. The thing I knew is done. I'm out. I'll go be European now. Other people, and people say the exact same thing about Syria. Other people, they want to go back. They just want to go make a living, raise a family until they can go back. So there's also this idea that, like, if you're bringing in refugees, it means that like you're adding all these people to your population forever, forever and ever and ever. And I think there's also like, you know, there could also be some intermediate programs, perhaps. Like, okay, like this person can have a 5-year residency, and then we'll reassess the situation. You know, if they want to go back. I don't agree with that. I think that people should be able to walk through the world and go to wherever they go and be welcome. You know, I think it actually helps economies. I think that if the thing that drives wages down, for instance, this is the big complaint, they're stealing our job. The thing that drives wages down is the illegalization of people. That's why drugs are expensive and that's why labor is cheap. If you make something illegal, it affects the whole economics around it. So if this person wasn't scared of getting deported, right, maybe they wouldn't be willing to work for so cheap because they don't have to worry. Well, if they don't get a job, you know? So I think actually that's and there's stuff that shows that, like in Italy, for instance, the last wave of migrant labor during the 70s from the south of Italy to the north, originally they were making really small wages, but then they became the fighting sector of the labor movement, and they ended up benefiting all Italians. Everyone's wages went up because they actually won their struggle.
I've heard the argument that like there's a so-called STEM crisis, science, technology, engineering, in the U.S. and that it's kind of a manufacturing crisis, and that visas are used to bring in, you know, a lot of science and technology employees to suppress salaries in that sphere. I don't know how, I don't know what the statistics are, but I don't know if that might be one explanation for our willingness to do visas over other mechanisms.
For cheaper labor for
high salaries, like for engineers and different technology and sort of, you know, professional class
medical people too.
Interesting.
And manufacture just because there is the talent in the U.S., but they just want to high wage.
I haven't really gone deep into it, but like there's there's always this call to do STEM educational programs to fill all these needed jobs. Like there's a crisis, in terms of not having enough people to fill them. And so that would then justify bringing in people on visas from other countries to fill this lack of qualified people. And yet I wonder if there really are a lack of qualified, I'm sure in very specific fields, of course, there's always fluctuations in people's, background and preparation and job availability. But I wonder, and I've heard people make that case, that it's manufactured.
I forgot to mention I met on the beaches, I met guys who were interpreters for the U.S. military or the British military in the wars and couldn't get brought over. So they just took a boat over in the middle of the night, 4 a.m, and I'm hanging out on the beach with this Iraqi doctor who is an interpreter for the U.S. military who thinks, when I get to Athens, I'm just going to buy a plane ticket to London. And I'm like, it probably isn't going to work. I don't want to break this guy's heart, but I'm like, dude, you're not going to buy a plane ticket to London. You're not a doctor anymore. You're a refugee now, and they're going to treat you like one. You can't fly to London. Maybe you've flown to London before, but not anymore. And he was an interpreter for the U.S. military. Risked his whole life. People want to kill him now. And I said, the U.S. doesn't bring you to the U.S.? No, they can't do that. And even if they can, even if you actually manage to, prove yourself to the people that you risked your life for who didn't care about your house, you prove that you're safe, you're not a security threat, like all the other Iraqi refugees who are apparently running around creating terrorist attacks that none of us hear about, then the wait is super, super long. You could get decapitated in that time, And so they end up on the beaches. I met, guys from Iraq and Afghanistan who had done that. Maybe one more question, and then...
With the boats is full, they look like they were wall-to-wall people and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Are the refugees showing up with... Are they able to bring stuff, or are they pretty much with clothes on their back?
That's a good question. Well, there's a lot of things, right? So often these boats either... So often you'll hear stories about the smugglers just taking everyone's bags and throwing them in the water, not even saying... Hey everyone, get your phone out. We're gonna throw your bag in the water. No, they just throw it in the water to make more room to cram more and more and more people in. The more people, the more money they make per boat. But there's just the clothes on their back is this concept of some of these people are poor. A lot of these people have stuff in Turkey in storage, they have stuff back home that's going to get sent to them. So they might just come with a backpack, which is crazy enough, but, they've got stuff somewhere. Some people would have bags and stuff, but often they would get thrown in the water. Other times they might be on a boat that was really heavy and they got freaked out and they threw their own bags over to try to make the boat lighter and stuff. And that's very, very common. People often throw their passports in the water too if they're not from... At the time when I was there, before Macedonia and Serbia closed their borders, you could make it into Europe if you were from Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, or Eritrea. And so if you weren't, you throw your passport in the water and say you are. like I saw a lot of Pakistanis getting deported when I was on the ferry. And Pakistanis are like, you know, that's like the biggest threat in Europe is Pakistanis, apparently, especially in England. They say, oh, why are they coming here? They don't have a war. Yeah, they do. You know, where do you think the Taliban lives? In Afghanistan, where they're being fought? No, they're in Pakistan. That's where bin Laden was living. When ISIS and the Taliban are fighting, and last week the Afghan military announced that they had won a major offensive against ISIS, and they'd driven them 7 kilometers. 7 kilometers where? Into Pakistan. You know? But then you've got people from Pakistan coming, pretending they're Afghan, because Pakistanis aren't allowed into Europe as refugees, and Afghans are, so they throw their papers out. We have Palestinians pretending to be Syrian, because Palestinians aren't considered refugees in Europe. Crazy. And then we even had, I think we had Chinese Muslims pretending to be Afghan as well, like Uyghurs from China. So there's also that sort of like, the fact that Europe created certain nationalities that were considered legitimate and certain ones that weren't have caused this weird social scene where you're talking to somebody and you're like, I really don't think you're from Afghanistan, but like, okay, you know, which part of Afghanistan are you from? Oh, Kabul, interesting, yeah, yeah, the big city. You know, but it's all, it's fine. There's some comedy in all of it as well. Anyways, yeah, so that's my talk. If folks, want, like, more resources or wanna, I can send you, like, links for some of the organizations. If you also, like, you're a refugee and you came here, if you're involved in the work and you wanna tell me stuff about either my talk or things I should know about or, you know, connect in the future, let's chat. And I'm going to sing at 7 if you want to stick around.